My name is Gizem Karaali, and I'm a professor of mathematics and statistics at Pomona College, which is in Claremont, California, United States. I think I was almost always pretty good at math, but I think because I was good at doing school and math was part of that. So it wasn't necessarily something I was exceptionally good at other than my other classes. I actually really liked my language arts classes and writing and reading. So I think it happened in two stages. The first one was in college. I was an electrical engineering major, and in my first year, I realized all the cool kids were doing math double majors. So you can understand my sense of coolness, of course, here. So I decided I have to do a double major in math as well. So that's kind of how I got into math. And then when I was finishing my undergraduate degree, I felt like engineering wasn't quite for me. And so I was very lucky to get into this amazing program at University of California, Berkeley on logic and the methodology of science. I felt I wasn't quite cut out for it. Like it was, so engineering was a little bit maybe more applied than I could handle, and this was maybe a little bit more pure than I could handle. So somehow I took math classes as well, and I felt like a lot more home there. And so I guess that's why I ended up doing math. So my original doctoral dissertation topic was in representation theory, and representation theory is a big mouthful, right? But what it means is it takes these abstract mathematical structures from algebra mostly, right? Like groups and so on, and thinks of them in terms of how they act on more concrete objects, which mathematically they basically are vector spaces. So what you're doing in some sense is advanced linear algebra. But things get really interesting when you're dealing with infinite dimensional objects and so on and so forth. And there's a lot of analysis in it as much as you want. There's a lot of geometry in it if you want. There's a lot of combinatorial ways to see it if you want. So in some sense, or topology. So I feel like representation theory is sort of, it is a subfield of mathematics, yes, but it has so much reach and so many different flavors of it that if you wanted to be, like, if you were interested at all, I'm sure you would find the flavor that you would like. These days, the math research that I'm working on most is more algebraic combinatorics, which is actually still representation theory related, but combinatorics says we like counting things. And so this is thinking about these abstract objects acting on concrete things, but now you're thinking about how many different ways they can count, that you can count, how these things act. What comes to my mind is, for instance, in undergraduate, I wasn't really, I think, doing my studies right. Like, I mean, I did what I thought I needed to do to get good grades. I went to class regularly, I took notes, and I studied the way I had studied in high school and whatever. But I didn't figure out that, like, there are other ways to engage with or understand the material, especially when it comes to math. And in grad school, I figured out a little bit better how I should have studied when I was an undergrad. I mean, for myself, I don't know. Of course, it may not apply to other people, but I always felt like when I was learning something, I was learning it very superficially. In grad school, I realized, oh, these are the types of questions I should have asked when I was learning these things. And these are the types of activities I should have done, like read up on the people who are doing these things, read up on the backgrounds of these problems that people are dealing with, so that I could have a better understanding of where things were coming from. And then I was also not a great graduate student. And so, like, I didn't really figure out how to be a good graduate student until I finished that and I became a postdoc and I realized, okay, oh, this is what I should have done in grad school. So, like, I keep learning a little late how to do things, I think. So I always felt throughout, and maybe I still sometimes do, even though now I'm a full professor, so I should be happy. I'm okay, right? But I still feel like I think I'm a little bit more comfortable now. But I all throughout I felt like Like there were things I didn't know how I should do the right way. The first one is the Journal of Humanistic Mathematics that I edit with Mark Huber from Claremont McKenna College, which is a sister college for Pomona College, where I work. And I am very excited that this journal exists. It's the kind of journal that I would have wanted to read or write for. And I am very excited that a lot of people do find it interesting as well. So Journal of Humanistic Mathematics, we started publishing in 2011. So with two issues every year, and we publish all kinds of articles and essays and memoirs and sort of sometimes reports on various things. We publish poetry, we publish short fiction. We will be publishing in the next few issues, I think, some screenplays, and so and we publish some artwork. We also publish sort of rants and very argumentative perspective pieces and so on and so forth. We try to keep it, I mean, respectable, but we want to sort of provide an outlet for different kinds of conversations about mathematics. The other thing that I'd say I'm very proud of is, I mean, it started around the same time, actually, around 2011, 2012 or something like that, with Lily Kajavi of Loyola Marymount University, Los Angeles. And we started thinking about mathematics for social justice and thinking about teaching mathematics for social justice. And we saw that there were a lot of people working in this field trying to create materials, course materials for their students. And we thought that it would be useful, right, to put some of them out there for other people who don't necessarily have the time to develop their own materials, but who are curious about what this construct is all about, like what does it mean to teach math for social justice. We wanted to sort of create resources for faculty, basically. And we were very lucky. We just thought it would be one nice volume, which would be sort of nice and tidy and so on. And we got so many good submissions when we asked for contributions from people that it became two volumes. It's been, I mean, about a decade in the making. And you might have seen them. I don't know if you can see them. I have them because I thought you should see them. They're very important. This is the first one. And this is the one that that came out in 2019. And it has a few essays as well as sort of teaching resources for different topics and different types of mathematics and different types of social justice topics. And this is the second one, which came out a couple of years later, which is more focused on statistics and quantitative literacy. So it's more introductory materials. This doesn't have any essays except one we wrote, Lily and I wrote at the very end, about sort of, if you are curious about this, what next could you think about? How would you move forward? And I mean, Lily and I have worked very hard on this project, but I mean, it's certainly not our doing, right? Like we basically, I see us as, in some sense, midwives. Like we helped give birth to this thing, which was a lot of other people's works, but we were sort of, how should I say, conductors, or somehow like we conducted, not in the sense of like organizing and musical conducting, but sort of transmitting. I had many people I looked up to throughout my life, but I never really thought that I could or should emulate any of them, because I felt like I wasn't like any of them. I always felt like people were either so much smarter than me, or they worked so much harder than me, or, I mean, they had the capacity to work so much harder than me, and maybe both. Some people had both, right? And so I never really felt like I could emulate them. Now, people, I mean, I did say I had a lot of good friends throughout grad school. UC Berkeley was wonderful in that there were a lot of graduate students, and a lot of us were international students too, so we sort of hung out together, and we were going through somewhat similar things, and that really helped. I do like John von Neumann because he was a genius, but he also said, and I don't like him just because he's a genius, but I like him because he's a genius, and he's a genius who said, young man, of course, I'm not a young man, so that totally doesn't apply to me. I'm neither young nor a man. But anyway, young man, in mathematics, you do not understand things. You just get used to them. And I mean, he's a genius. He like revolutionized mathematics in the middle of the 20th century, early 20th century. And he's saying, you do not have to understand everything. Like, I feel like this is a sort of a license for me to move on a little bit more. And then maybe I'll go back and I'll understand better. I like the statement. I don't idolize him, though, because I do know that he has, of course, made a lot of interesting and maybe wrong, decisions in his life and so on. I mean, I really understood that need to idolize someone when Maryam Mirzakhani won the Fields Medal. She did math slowly. She was a slow thinker. Now, I don't really buy that. Like, I don't think she was really that slow in comparison to a lot of other people. But I do appreciate what she's saying about, like, you don't have to be the quickest in the room. You don't have to be the one who gets things very, very quickly. You can take your time and you can digest things. And I sort of see like there's some parallels with von Neumann. These people inspire me. I think math can be a very freeing space in many ways. There are some people who look like they're gatekeepers, and maybe they are trying to be gatekeepers. But there are also just as many, I think, people who are like trying to make it a lot more welcoming. And I think it's important to try to find your own people. And those people can be peers. They don't have to be people who are far more advanced than you in mathematics. But find your people and find joy in math. That's what I would suggest.